was only there for like 3 months. Somebody broke in, stole like 82 pair of shoes. That put me in the hole like 17,000. Like, at that point, like, I wanted to quit every day.
I swear this famous shit just happened overnight. For sure these hoes were so uptight, but now they so polite. All I see is fake love, smiles, and overbites. But I'm pimping, nigga, Dolomite. I remember when I was like 10, maybe 9. Ricky had a juice.
Kenneth Taylor, shoe doctor. I run Detroit, you know, on the shoe scene.
Yes, sir.
I'm 27 years old. I run a shoe doctor. We clean, customize, and restore shoes. We bring shoes back to life. Me and my older brother, we always, like my mama, we had her standing in the cold to get us Jordans. Like, we waking up at 5 o'clock in the morning to get the new J's, you know? Okay. Like, him especially, like, he recruiting them, like, look, these come out this weekend, bro. Like, put her on it, we gotta get them, so, you know. From a young age, I always had Jordans, like every year. So growing up, when I got older, out of high school, you know, I got a job and I started buying more and more Jordans. Majority of my check used to go to the fly Jordans that's coming out, you feel me? So I used to stand in line every weekend with 100 other people getting Jordans. And then I stood in line with so many people that I knew people in line when I was coming to stand in line. It's like a little community now. Like, So long story short, I racked up probably like 40, 50 pair of J's. And how my basement set up is kind of like this setup. I had the racks going around, like probably like 3 racks a piece, and then like probably like 40, 50 pair of J's going around. But it's the basement. So I'm coming down there. I ain't wearing Jordans for probably, I ain't wear these probably like 6 months. Open up the box and wear them. It's spider webs in there and everything. Like, start calling shoe repair shops in the city. Every shoe repair shop, like, we don't clean gym shoes. We don't accept gym shoes. Only casual shoes, only dress shoes. We don't take gym shoes. I'm like, well, damn, I stand in line with 100 plus people every weekend. I know it's money in it. Like, I know for a fact. So I'm like, I test the water. I go to work the next day. I ask my homeboy, like, how much you pay somebody to clean your shoes? Like, yeah, about $10, $20. Like, I don't want to clean them. Like,
especially
right.
When you got a lot of
people. Exactly. The 3 for $10 was that was like the beginner deal. That was like to draw people in because, you know, people didn't really trust me with their shoes. So, like, that was like the main question. Like, if I give you my shoes, how I know I'm going to get them back?
Right.
So I had to give them the 3 for $10, you know, pair of shoes, deep clean. It was still the same service, bottom of the shoe to the top of the shoe around your ankles and your laces clean. But it was 3 for $10. Nah, I charged $20 a pair, though.
There we go.
Right. Instagram just hit the scene not too long ago. Instagram probably was out for about no longer than a year. Okay. And I had probably like 3,000, 4,000 followers. Like, I had, you know, people ain't had that many, like 100K back then. That's people true. Had like less than like 7,000 followers, 10K, right. 20 if you were somebody in the city that you really know somebody. So, started posting them. Like, I started cleaning his shoes, my homeboy's shoes, you know, posting them online before and after pictures. People started calling me like the first day. Like the first day, I think I got like 3 calls. Went and picked up their shoes, did them, posting them. Calls never stopped after that. Like from that day on, like my phone never stopped ringing. I had a shop on 7 Mile of Van Dyke. Like we was over there. I had that shop for like a year and about a couple months. And the rent was like $950 over there. And it was all right because everywhere else in the area would be like $1,200, $1,300. So I kind of got a deal. It was kind of small, but I was still making it manage. And I was on the corner of 7 Mile and Van Dyke. So a guy I knew that do t-shirts, he approached me. He was like, you want to go half on the shop that's right down the street? It was like probably like 3 blocks away. But it wasn't on the corner in the lit up section of Van Dyke. So he's like, it's only going to be like $300 a month. I'm like, hell yeah, I'm paying $950 plus lights, water, and gas.
Exactly.
And I'm paying nothing but $300. Like, shit, come on, bro. How fast can I move?
Exactly.
I moved down there. I was only there for like 3 months. Somebody broke in, stole like 82 pair of shoes. That put me in the hole like 17,000. Like, at that point, like, I wanted to quit every day. Like, I was cleaning shoes to pay people for shoes. Like, it was so backwards. I used to wake up every morning like, I'm really about to clean these shoes to pay.
To get out of the hole, basically.
Exactly.
And that's the thing. You could have quit.
Yeah.
That could have been there. You could have moved on to the next thing. But I guess, would you say that at that point you had reached enough following and enough flow? Like, to, I know I'm going to get out.
It was like, basically, like, I opened up this big ass lane with this big lane for people to clean shoes, and if I just fall off, somebody gonna step in my spot. And I'm not gonna be feeling comfortable going back to work. I'm working while I see somebody else being a shoe doctor. Like, we gonna get through this.
We gonna get through this.
In the beginning, I used to harp on, like, people don't support me, family don't support me, nothing. Like, to this day, like, I can't think of, like, probably one or two people come get their shoes cleaned that's in my family. Like, I got a nice-ass family, so, you know, I got family members that never stepped a foot inside my business. I got a majority of my family never stepped inside my business. You know, and it's not nothing against them or nothing. It's like when you open up a business, you can't expect the closest people around you to support you. If you expect them to support you, then you basically gonna fail. Like, you can't just expect somebody to support what you're doing.
No doubt.
You gotta do what you're doing because you know it's gonna be successful, and then people gonna support that. People not gonna support you hoping and wishing. Like, you gotta make moves. You know, it's not really, I ain't gonna say it's the cleaner, it's the way you clean your shoes, really. It's the technique to clean your shoes. I can't really give you my technique on camera, but I mean, you could use this and just go get your shoes clean, but it's still not, you really want to get them serviced.
Exactly. If you could give like any advice to a young aspiring entrepreneur, you know, maybe somebody, a young dude from Highland Park like yourself, what would that be? Just somebody just trying to get their little business off the ground.
Like, the main thing is you got to be consistent, whatever you do.
Yes, sir.
Like, consistency is key. Yep. Like, you can't wake up today and be going hard for 30 days and then stop for 3 months. Like, that ain't going to get you nowhere. Like, since I started Shoe Doctor, I can't think of that one day I haven't cleaned a shoe, and that's probably on a Sunday, because that's my family day.
Exactly.
Like, I've been cleaning shoes straight for like 5 years. It's consistency, bro. Like, if you gonna do it, you gotta do it. You can't just do it on your off days or your free time. Ain't no off days.
Yeah, be all in.
You gotta be all in, and you gonna reap the rewards.
That's
but
right.
You don't.
That's real.
You get what you put in. You feel me?
That's right. And then, I'm sure it's the same thing with social media too, because I know you dropped some game on me, but consistency with that.
Consistency, like, you gotta post every day, like, during the week. Like, everybody know, I probably post like 20 times on Instagram on my story a day. That gives people a reminder to come in, get your shoes serviced, look what I'm doing.
Exactly.
You feel me? On Facebook, I get personal. You know, you gotta get personal with your fan base, your customers. You know, people want to engage in what you're doing, want to be a part of what you're doing. You can't be afraid to say what you're doing.
Exactly. Now,
everybody struggles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people want to hear the struggle more than the win.
Right. Struggling.
You feel me?
Yeah.
Exactly. Like,
it's like they say, it's beauty in the struggle.
Exactly. You got to embrace it. Like, you can't be afraid to tell somebody what you're going through, because they probably going through it worse than you.
Man, that's I might have to play that a lot. But that's just so real, and so much of us, so many of us, we scared to just start from the beginning.
Yeah.
Everybody was, I say this all the time too, everybody was the fake something until they became the real.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? I always share the Soldier Boy used to have a rubber band chain story. He, like, 99% of us gonna be, we ain't showing our face
with
a
rubber band chain.
But if you know how good you are,
you know what you're gonna be, then you know where you're gonna go. Like, you gotta know the end route. You can't just be like, I wanna wake up. How you gonna do it? What steps gonna take you to get there? You can't just be like, I wanna be the number one person at this, but you don't even got no roadmap to get you there. Like, I got a business plan, it changed probably 20 times. Like,
and that's what they say, it's a living document.
It's a living document, it's gonna change every day. Like, it's changing right now, I'm about to be mobile. Like, that wasn't in my business plan 2 years ago.
Exactly.
But now it's in my business plan today. I got a plan.
That's gonna be huge.
You feel me? I got a plan. Like, that's where you should start off with, a plan,
yes, sir.
And then execute it.